It's time for monthly builds for November of 2018. Howdy, howdy guys, Ponchato here, and welcome to Monthly Builds. In these videos, I show you the parts I'd use for building gaming PCs at new budgets every month. And this time we'll be looking at $500, $1,000, and $1,500 PCs. To keep up with new prices and components, I put up a new video every month, so be sure to subscribe to stay up to date. Before we get to the builds, let's look at some PC industry news. AMD's next generation CPU architecture, Zen 2, is offering a significant increase in performance. According to Bits and Chips, an Italian tech publication, Zen 2 could bring with it a 13% IPC gain over Zen Plus and 16% over Zen 1. These results were from scientific benchmarks and not gaming, so they should be taken with a grain of salt, but we should expect to see a healthy increase in per-core performance when the next generation of Ryzen processors is released sometime next year. Also from Team Red, the Radeon RX 590 graphics card was just released. Still powered by the Polaris architecture, it's offering higher clock speeds and therefore more performance than the RX 580. That higher clock speed is made possible because it's built on the 12 nanometer process, and so it should be slightly more power efficient and therefore produce less heat than the RX 580. AMD is also offering a free game bundle with the RX 590, which comes with Resident Evil 2, Devil May Cry 5, and The Division 2. Suggested retail for the 590 is $280, about $40 to $50 higher than the 580 8GB. Not a bad deal. In response to AMD's launch of the RX 590, Nvidia rushed out another new version of the GTX 1060, this time with GDDR5X memory. I think this makes the fifth variant of the 1060 now. Anyway, the likely reasoning for releasing another variant of the 1060 rather than releasing the 2060 is because retailers are still sitting on large stockpiles of GTX 10 series cards. With that in mind, Nvidia likely doesn't want to cannibalize sales of the last generation and leave retailers up the creek. No word yet on performance of the new 1060. Here's a fun screw up. ASUS Z390 motherboards were apparently injecting software into Windows installations without people's knowledge or consent. The software included ASUS's Armory Crate and a system service called ASUS Update Check. To be fair here, ASUS was probably just trying to be helpful. The programs were designed to grab the latest drivers for your hardware and install them with little or no effort needed on your part. And it's only enabled by a somewhat buried option in the UEFI, but the option is turned on by default. This doesn't strike me as having any kind of bad intentions, but it does come across as a pretty glaring problem with transparency. In case someone from ASUS ever sees this, don't do that. Sure, make the software available and give people the option to install it, but that's the important word there, option. Don't just do things without people's permission. That's a no-no. Over on the gaming side, EA DICE announced that Battlefield 5's Battle Royale mode, named Firestorm, won't be available until March of 2019. This mode is being developed by Criterion Games, working with DICE, and it's set to have up to 64 players in 16 squads. EA DICE has also released a roadmap of features coming to Battlefield 5, so the game will be evolving quite a bit over the next few months. For the last bit of news, CCP, the developers of EVE Online, say they expected the VR market to boom much sooner than what actually happened. They made a pretty big push into VR for both the HTC Vive and Oculus Rift with their release of EVE Valkyrie, which didn't end up as successful as they had hoped. Their CEO said, "We expected VR to be 2 to 3 times as big as it was, period. You can't build a business on that." He went on to say more data is needed to determine whether or not VR is worth the effort, and he specifically pointed out that a lot of people bought VR headsets just to try them out, but then set them down and never used them again. As for my personal opinion, I think VR right now is like cell phones were in the 90s. Expensive, uncommon, and just not appealing to most people. But I fully expect VR to become ubiquitous within the next 5 to 10 years, particularly as mobile platforms become faster and cheaper. But we'll see what happens. With the news covered, let's get to the builds. First up, the $500 build. For the CPU, I went with AMD's Ryzen 3 2200G for $100. This is a simple 4-core processor on the AM4 socket and unlocked, so it allows for overclocking. It also comes with reasonably powerful built-in graphics, but because this is a gaming build, we'll be including a dedicated graphics card, Nvidia's GTX 1050 for $130. The 1050 is actually one of my favorite budget GPUs because it has such a great price to performance ratio. At 1080p, it can handle just about any game today with low to medium settings, and being a low power card, it won't produce much heat. For the motherboard, I picked ASUS's B450M-A for $75. It's a micro ATX board, and so it'll fit into basically any case with room to spare, and has an M.2 slot for an SSD and 4 RAM slots to add more memory in the future. For the memory, I picked Corsair's Vengeance 2 by 4GB kit for $70. It seems that RAM prices are finally getting back down to reasonable levels, and a 2400MHz kit like this is perfect for a budget build. For the SSD, I picked ADATA's SU800 128GB for $29. SSDs, like memory, have dropped in price significantly, and for under $30, it'd be silly not to include an SSD in all but the tightest of budgets. Bulk storage goes to my longtime pick, Western Digital's Blue 1TB for $46. Plenty of space for programs, games, and media. Power goes to ThermalTake with their Smart 600 Watt for $35. I actually just used the lower wattage Smart 500 in my G5400 build, and I've used ThermalTake Smart Series of power supplies for quite a while now. 5-year warranty, 80 plus efficiency, and the 120mm fan stays quiet. Finally, for the case, I picked Rosewill's FBM X1 for $18. This is another part I used in my G5400 build, the main reason being it's cheap and still includes a window. For a budget like this, it's really best to keep the case as cheap as possible so you can use that money on more important parts. Altogether, these parts come out to just over budget at $502. Because it's on the AM4 socket, this system will also be a great base for future upgrades. A new CPU will be easy to add, you can swap out the 1050 for something more powerful like a 1060 or RX 580, and you'll have two more RAM slots to add more memory when it's needed. Click the link in the description to pick up these components for yourself. Next up, we'll look at the $1,000 build, which will give you a pretty significant step up in performance. The processor I picked is AMD's Ryzen 5 2600 for $160. With 6 cores and 12 threads and being unlocked, this is a gnarly CPU for mid-range builds. I have a strong feeling that 6 cores will be more than enough for gaming for a very long time to come. To help push the overclocking boundaries, I chose Scythe's Mugen 5 Revision B CPU cooler for $48. This is actually one of my favorite CPU coolers because it's quiet, it's strong, and it's really easy to install. Plus, at under 50 bucks, it competes closely with significantly more expensive coolers. For the graphics card, I went with Nvidia's GTX 1060 6GB for $250. The 1060 6GB has been a go-to favorite for mid-range builds pretty much since it was released. It can run high to ultra settings in almost every game at 1080p, and even handle 1440p at reasonable settings and frame rates. For the motherboard, I again picked ASUS's B450M-A for $75. As explained before, this board has everything you'll need to upgrade in the future. 4 RAM slots, space for an M.2 SSD, and because it has the AM4 socket, you'll be able to drop in a new CPU when you decide to upgrade. I picked Corsair for the memory again, this time their 16GB 3000MHz kit for $130. Ryzen processors are very dependent on memory speed, and going with faster memory like this can noticeably improve performance in gaming and other tasks. For the SSD, I picked Samsung's 500GB 970 EVO for $117. The 970 EVO is one of the fastest SSDs available, and because it's an NVMe drive, sequential read and write speeds are measured in gigabytes per second rather than megabytes. Bulk storage goes to the Western Digital Blue 1TB for $46. Even though 500 gigs on the SSD will cover most people's needs, it's always nice to have plenty of extra storage. For power, I picked Seasonic's Focus Plus 750FX for $100. The Focus and Focus Plus series show up in my recommendations all the time because they're well built, efficient, and they're really quiet. In fact, Focus Plus power supplies can run passive cooling under low load, which means they'll completely stop the fan at idle. That's better than quiet, that's silent. Finally, for the case, I picked Deepcool's Earl Case RGB for $75. Being an ATX mid tower, there's plenty of room inside for cable management and for making everything look pretty. It's decorated with an RGB LED strip and tempered glass side panel to show off everything inside. And with the power supply shroud, hiding cables and making your PC look great is super simple. With everything together, this build comes out to almost exactly $1,000. This PC will give you crazy good performance and easy upgradability in the future, depending on your needs. Click the link in the description to get these parts for your build. In fact, it's pretty similar to another PC I have planned soon, so subscribe to make sure you don't miss it. Now for the last build, let's see what $1,500 can buy you today. For the CPU, I picked AMD's Ryzen 7 2700 for $266. With 8 cores and 16 threads and lots of room for overclocking, this is one of the fastest consumer processors you can buy today. Because that level of performance comes with a bit of heat, I picked Scythe's Fuma for $47 to cool it. The Fuma is actually the best air cooler I've tested and competes closely with liquid AIOs. It shares the same installation process with the Mugen 5, and so it's super easy to put together. For the GPU, I picked NVIDIA's RTX 2070 for $550. The 2070 is one of the fastest GPUs available, very similar in performance to the 1080 Ti. With a card like this, 4K gaming is well within reach without needing to turn the graphics settings all the way down. VR games will also run extremely well since this is such a strong card. All of that will be plugged into the B450 Plus from ASUS for $105. This is a full-size ATX motherboard and comes with plenty of features and connections. 4 RAM slots, M.2 SSD slot, USB-C on the back, and ASUS's Aura Sync RGB header to run any RGB stuff you might like. For the RAM, I picked G-Skill's Ripjaws 5 16GB kit for $140. This is a 3200MHz kit, so it can run crazy fast, which makes a big difference in performance with Ryzen CPUs, like the 2700 we're using here. For the SSD, I again picked Samsung's 970 EVO for $117. With 500GB of storage, you'll have plenty of room for Windows, all your programs, and all your games, unless you have a crazy big library. To fit that crazy big library, I picked Western Digital's blue 4TB drive for $100. 4TB is an insane amount of storage, and unless you're shooting 4K videos every day, it'll take you a very long time to fill up. For power, I picked Seasonic's Focus Plus 750FX for $100. 750 watts is more than enough to run this build, the Focus Plus is quiet and efficient, and reliability won't be a concern since it comes with a 10-year warranty. That's a long time. Finally, for the case, I picked Thermaltake's Versa C23 RGB for $76. This is a full-size ATX case with a tempered glass side panel and built-in RGB LED controller that can control both ring fans and the LEDs on the case. It also has brushed aluminum front and top panels and can support a 240mm radiator on both the front and the top. Altogether, these parts come out to exactly $1,500 and will provide incredible performance now and for quite some time into the future. For an astoundingly fast gaming PC, click the link in the description to pick up these parts for yourself. So that's it for the November edition of Monthly Builds. If you're building a PC for the first time, welcome to the community and be sure to check out my build videos to see how it's done. If you're a veteran and just needed to catch up, I hope these recommendations helped you. Hit subscribe and click the bell icon to get notified of new videos as soon as they're up. So guys, if you like this video, hit the like button. If you want to see more, hit subscribe. And if you have any questions on the news or these builds, leave them in the comments below. Thanks for watching. I hope I helped, and I'll see you in the next video.